If you pay any attention to American politics, you'll probably hear two words pretty frequently: Democrats and Republicans. And because of this, one would think that the United States is divided about 50-50 between the country's two largest parties. But in fact, you'd be mistaken. Only 30% of Americans are Democrats, matched by 30% Republicans. The rest of the American people, 40% of the country's population, are independents, members of neither party. So why do we always hear about only the Democratic and Republican parties? Perhaps it's because it's been 172 years since a member of another party was elected to the presidency. And even before Democrats and Republicans existed, the US has always had a system dominated by two parties. But every once in a while, a third-party candidate will perform surprisingly well in an election and have a major impact on its outcome. These third-party bids occur when the country's at a crossroads and is eager for change, and they say a lot about the US at the time. Hello and welcome to That Is Interesting. I'm your host, Carter. Today, American presidential elections that were influenced by a major third-party bid. Throughout American history, there have been so far 58 presidential elections, but only in 11 of them has a third-party candidate received more than 5% of the popular vote. In this three-part series, I'll take you chronologically through each of these elections, looking at the circumstances that made the public desire change, and how it ultimately affected who became president. Part 2 and Part 3 are up as well, so make sure to watch them if you enjoyed this video. Only once in American history has the United States elected a president who was not a member of any political party: George Washington. The first US president was elected twice with little to no opposition. But following America's only independent presidency, the rest of the country's history has been one of two parties. This chart shows it pretty well. Each color represents a political party, and the longest bar each year designates the winner of the presidency, the exception being elections with a star by the candidate's name, which shows candidates that lost the popular vote but won the Electoral College. First, the two parties were the Federalists and the Democratic Republicans, then the Democrats and the Whigs, and finally, the Democrats and Republicans. The orange and purple bars between the red and blue show the percent of the vote that went to a third-party candidate. Some years, the ones we'll talk about, were significantly larger than others, elections where a third-party candidate played a major role. First, the election of 1832. Prior to the election of Andrew Jackson, the Democratic-Republican Party, founded by Thomas Jefferson, dominated American politics, spurred by widespread opposition to partisan division. In fact, the party had grown so successful that in 1824, the two main candidates for the presidency, John Quincy Adams and Andrew Jackson, were both Democratic-Republicans, members of the same party. Adams, the Secretary of State and son of the second US president, had won the election despite losing the popular vote, but the party and the country had become incredibly divided. Jackson, for one, was furious, seeing the election as stolen from him. In 1828, the Tennessee senator decided to challenge Adams once again. By this point, the Democratic Republicans had divided in two. Supporters of Adams formed the National Republican, or Anti-Jacksonian Party, and supporters of Jackson, the Democratic Party. This time, the controversial Jackson won. In 1832, he was up for re-election, and the Anti-Jacksonians nominated Secretary of State Henry Clay. In a time of intense political division and party realignment, Americans were hungry for another choice. This choice came in the form of the Anti-Masonic Party, who ran on the sole platform of opposition to Freemasons, members of a secretive social club that have been the subject of many ridiculous conspiracy theories. But fear of Freemasons was also on the rise across America. The fact that it coincided with a time of political division and desires for a third-party choice led the Anti-Masons to do pretty well in 1832. They nominated Attorney General William Wirt, who in fact had been a Freemason himself, and believed Masons to be, and I quote, "intelligent men of high and honorable character." Despite running as the anti-Masonic nominee, Wirt refused to publicly criticize Freemasons, hoping instead that his candidacy would take enough votes away from Democrats that Andrew Jackson, seen by many Americans as a tyrant, would lose re-election. In the end, Wirt won 7.78% of the popular vote, and won Vermont in the Electoral College. On top of that, South Carolina's delegates voted for Virginia Governor John Floyd, who believed that states should be allowed to nullify laws imposed by the federal government. This absurd idea was popular in the South, who wanted to preserve the terrible practice of slavery, even if the federal government made it illegal. Jackson, though a slave-owning Southerner, was opposed to nullification, and as such, the Nullifier Party was formed in opposition to him. John Floyd became the party's nominee in 1832, but he had no desire to run and didn't receive any popular votes. He did, however, win all the electoral votes from South Carolina, a future hotbed of secession. But all of these parties that were formed in opposition to Andrew Jackson weren't enough to stop his re-election. If anything, they split the vote of those who were against him, making his victory easier. But regardless, even if the vote of the anti-Jacksonians, anti-Masons, and nullifiers were all added up, it still would have resulted in a Jackson landslide. Following defeat in 1832, the anti-Jacksonians and anti-Masons merged their parties together, founding the Whig Party. Next up, the election of 1848. By this point, slavery was becoming a much more contentious issue in America. The U.S. had just won the Mexican-American War, and had gained an immense amount of land, including Texas and California. As the country rapidly expanded west, many Americans disagreed over whether or not slavery should be allowed in new states. Many Democrats believed it should, but former President Martin Van Buren was not one of them. Van Buren had been president 12 years before, but was defeated for re-election. In 1848, he ran again, but this time he lost the Democratic nomination to Michigan Senator Lewis Cass, who believed, like many Democrats, that individual states should decide whether or not to allow slavery. Cass had the same opinions on slavery as Zachary Taylor, a general who gained nationwide fame in the Mexican-American War, but had no political experience. Taylor won the Whig Party's nomination, and as the candidates from each major party had the same views on such a controversial issue, Van Buren saw a third-party path to the presidency. The former president left the Democrats and helped found the Free Soil Party, which opposed the expansion of slavery. Democrats and Whigs alike who disagreed with slavery voted for Van Buren, giving him 10.13% of the popular vote, but carrying no states, in the most successful third-party run up to that point. Van Buren's Free Soil candidacy definitely affected the election, as the former Democratic president likely took votes from the Democratic nominee, Lewis Cass. Because of this, Cass lost, giving the election to Taylor. That all changed in 1856, when another former president made a third-party bid for the White House. Zachary Taylor had died not long after he was elected, and his vice president, Millard Fillmore, had taken over the job. But Fillmore's presidency would mark the end of the Whigs. Fillmore wanted another term as president, but his own party wouldn't even nominate him. Their nominee, famed General Winfield Scott, lost, and the party split in two. Northern anti-slavery Whigs formed the Republican Party. Meanwhile, a xenophobic secret society was beginning to form in opposition to immigration and Catholicism. Members, when asked about it, said, "I know nothing," leading to their name, the Know-Nothings. After the breakup of the Whigs, many Southern Whigs joined the Know-Nothings, transforming it into a political party who acted as a middle ground between the Democratic South and Republican North. In 1856, former President Fillmore became the Know-Nothing nominee, running against Secretary of State James Buchanan for the Democrats and California Senator John C. Fremont for the Republicans. The division of the Whigs had made the Know-Nothings a viable party, and having a former president at the helm meant that they were able to perform quite well for a third party. In the end, Fillmore won nearly 22% of the popular vote, as well as Maryland's electoral votes. Fremont won 33%, and Buchanan 45%. It's hard to say where Fillmore's 22% would have gone if he had not run, but it's likely that the former Whigs would have voted Republican, as they would go on to do in upcoming elections. If Fillmore hadn't run, or the Know-Nothings hadn't existed, John C. Fremont may have gone on to win the presidency instead of Buchanan. Buchanan failed to prevent the Civil War, and the country became much more divided during the one term he served. Today, he's remembered as one of America's worst presidents. If Fremont, who was much more radical in opposition to slavery than Lincoln, had been elected, the Civil War could have even begun in 1856. Perhaps he would not have been as effective as a war leader as Lincoln, and the Confederacy would have won, changing the entire path of American history. But if his military experience served him well and the Union came out successful, it could have been Fremont, not Lincoln, who would be memorialized as America's greatest president. It's hard to believe that all that could have changed because of one third-party campaign. If you enjoyed this video, be sure to watch part 2 and part 3, which are out right now. Thank you for watching this video, and I hope you learned something new. Subscribe for more content like this. I cover the countries, cities, people, and places of the world and beyond. These videos will leave you saying, "That is interesting."